Dear student, this is the second lecture. In the last lecture, I have discussed about the concept of fiber, its definition, and various properties and features of the fiber that we need to include to define textile fiber properly. As well as I have discussed the various physical and chemical properties of the fiber, which we shall discuss in this subject. So now I shall mention the various methods of investigation of structure of fiber. So one of the strong tool of structural investigation of the fiber, that is the FTIR. Okay, that is based on the absorption of infrared radiation by the textile materials. FTIR, full form is Fourier Transform Infrared Spectroscopy. I shall discuss later. Then next, another technique, optical and X-ray diffraction studies. So diffraction is a phenomenon of light. You know, you already taught in your school level classes in physics diffraction of light. So diffraction of light can be successfully used for the structural investigation of the fiber. Diffraction of either the optical or visible light or the diffraction of X-ray. So we shall discuss later how these diffraction of lights can be successfully utilized for the structural investigation of the textile fibers. Then microscopy, optical microscopy is very common, you know, but here we need to more learn about the electron microscopy, where electron or a beam of electrons are used for obtaining the microscopic image of the surface of the fiber. That is very important tool for understanding the morphology of the fiber and fine texture of the fiber surface. So that we shall learn in this subject. Then another tool is nuclear magnetic resonance, NMR. That is also one of the characterization tool. This tool, maybe I shall discuss later. If I have time, then I shall discuss about NMR in this subject. Otherwise, that can be discussed later on. Then optical birefringence and eye cohesion. These are the optical properties. They are coming under the optical properties of the fiber. Birefringence is basically based on the refractive index of the fiber. Refractive index, you know, if you can remember the definition of refractive index, it is well. Otherwise, I shall advise, please go through your physics book again, the science of light, diffraction, refraction, reflection, and all the laws and all the concepts again. That will be very useful for understanding these techniques. Dye cohesion is also another optical property I shall discuss. Then next topic will be the thermal analysis of textile fiber. There are various thermal analysis techniques for investigation of textile structure and features. Okay, they are named as TGA, DSC, TMA, DMA. These are all short names. The full name and full forms will be discussed when I shall discuss all these topics. Then density of the fiber, that is another important aspect. The measurement of density of the fiber. The measurement of density of the fiber is not so easy. There is a typical instrument which is called density gradient column that you need to know. You need to learn how to use density gradient column for the measurement of density of the fiber. Then molecular weight and its distribution. Molecular weight of the polymeric fiber, as the fibers are consisting of the polymer molecules, and the polymer molecules is having a certain degree of polymerization, and based on the degree of polymerization, the molecular weight of the polymer molecule will be there. But certainly the molecules, a fiber is consisting of a large number of molecules, and all the molecules are not having the same degree of polymerization. That is the most important information that we have to understand. All molecules which are present inside the fiber structure, they are not having the same degree of polymerization or same length. So their molecular weight also will vary. Okay, then to present the molecular weight of a fiber, we need to measure the mean molecular weight or average molecular weight, and as well as to present the variation or variability of the molecular weight, we need to present it in the form of molecular weight distribution. This is typically a probability distribution, and you also already taught the probability distribution in statistics, such as binomial distribution, normal distribution, gamma distribution. So maybe one distribution will be best fit for the molecular weight distribution of polymeric fiber. So all those measurements are there by the GPC method. GPC is a short form. Full name is gel permeation chromatography. Okay, this technique I shall not discuss in this subject. Okay, that may be discussed in your other subjects such as polymer chemistry or in the subject of polymer science. If you have interest, then you can go through this technique as a self-study. And there are other methods of molecular weight measurement, membrane osmometry, light scattering, male viscosity methods, etc. So by these methods, one can measure the average molecular weight of the polymeric fiber. Now come to the chemical structure. Basically, the structure of the fiber can be divided into two ways, chemical structure and physical structure. So at first, I shall brief about the chemical structure of the fiber. So chemical formula of a macromolecule or polymer that can be defined as this by this formula, X, A whole bracket N, Y. So here X and Y are the side end groups. A is the mar or monomer. Okay, this is the basic unit which is called as mar, and small n is the degree of polymerization. Okay, there will be a number of mars which will be added together to form a polymer, and there will be the side groups or end groups such as X and Y in this polymer. Okay, so in this way one can define the chemical formula of a polymer, and the polymers are actually the molecules. When we are talking about the molecules, they are the polymer molecules which are present inside a fiber. Now, classification of polymer. So, to understand the fiber, at first we need to understand polymer, because fibers are made of polymer molecules. So, there are various approaches of classification of polymers. There are various monomer characteristics, such as structure of monomers. Okay. Carbochain or heterochain structure of monomers. Okay, either all the monomers are having only the carbon, or other than carbon there will be other atoms such as oxygen, nitrogen, etc. When only carbon molecules are present, when only carbon atoms are present, they are carbochain monomers, or if there are carbon and other hetero atoms, then that is called heterochain monomer. The number of monomers used. Okay, homo polymer or copolymer. If a polymer is consisting of a single type of monomer, okay, that is called homopolymer. If there are two different monomers are used to form a polymer, then such kind of polymer is called copolymer. Chemical structure of the monomer. The polymers can be formed either by addition polymerization or by condensation polymerization. Okay, so then those polymers are called addition polymer or condensation polymer. Now, addition polymerization and condensation polymerization, I think already you know. Then functionality of the monomer. So based on the functionality of the monomer, the polymers may be linear polymer, branched polymer, or cross-linked polymer. So the formation of the polymer, okay, either in the form of linear configuration or branched configuration or cross-linked configuration, that depends on the functionality of the monomer, how the monomer is functionally active. Okay, so if it is capable of forming the linear polymer or branch polymer or crosslinked polymer, then based on the chemical groups present in the monomer, the polymers can be classified as polymers named as per the chemical group, such as polyamide, polyolefin, polyester, etc. So, by the name of the functional groups or chemical groups present in the polymer also can be classified, such as polyamide, polyolefin, polyester, polyurethane, etc. So, this is the basic classification of the polymer. Then, I shall discuss in brief about all those types of classes of polymers. The first one was the structure of monomer used, carbochain polymers and heterochain polymers. So, carbochain polymers contain only carbon atom, as I have mentioned, in their main chain. Polyethylene, polypropylene, polyacetylene, and all vinyl polymers are carbochain polymers because they are having only the carbon atoms in the monomer. And heterochain polymers consist of other atoms along with the carbon in their main chain. Okay, they are polyamides where the carbon and nitrogen two hetero atoms are present. Polyester where carbon and oxygen. Polyurethanes, okay, they are all the heterochain polymers. Okay, they are having the carbon atom as well as other than carbon atoms such as nitrogen, oxygen, etc. Then number of monomers used. The polymers like polyethylene containing a single repeating unit or single monomer, okay, such as ethylene. So a numbers of ethylene monomers are added together to form the polyethylene. So that's why it is a homopolymer. And polymers is containing two or more different groups or monomers or structural units are called copolymer. And the chain molecules contain different mark or different structural units. So the example of copolymers are acrylic, modacrylic, etc. The number of monomers used. Alternative copolymer. Okay, copolymer, the concept of copolymer you already now know when there will be the dissimilar monomer used to form a polymer. So, alternative copolymer. Example A, where you can see the black and empty circles. Okay, they are two dissimilar monomers and the two dissimilar monomers have their presence in the polymer chain in alternative way. Okay, this is alternating copolymer. Then periodic copolymer. Okay, there is a certain period of the alternation of the copolymers, of the co-monomers are there in the polymer chain. Okay, but that is not available here in this picture, the periodic copolymer. There will be a certain period of the repetition of the co-monomers or monomers present in the polymer chain. Then random copolymer, figure B, where you can see there is no periodic repetition, but there is a randomness of the alternation of the monomers, dissimilar monomers. Okay, black dots and the empty dots, white dots. Okay, their alternation does not follow any rule. Then statistical copolymer. Okay, in case of statistical copolymer, there will be the rule of statistics which will be followed for the alternation of the copolymer, alternation of the monomers in the copolymer. Okay, rule of statistics, a statistical theory will be followed for the alternation of the monomers in the copolymer. Then block copolymer, the figure C. Okay, block copolymer is defined as a macromolecule which is composed of a block in linear sequence. Block is a portion of the macromolecule comprising many constitutional units that has at least one feature which is not present in the adjacent portion. This is the explanation of the block copolymer. You can see a number of monomer, they will produce a block. Okay, this is the block of black monomers and this is a block of white monomers. And these two dissimilar monomers, they will add it together in this sequence to prepare the block copolymer. Now next is the graph copolymer. Okay, graph copolymer in which the second monomer link the first monomer from side or as a branch. Okay, as you can see in the figure D, okay, there is a grafting of some monomers or monomer chain or group of monomers to the main chain black polymer. Okay, so this kind of side linking of the group of monomers is called as grafting. Okay, this is the second type of monomers which are linked in the first monomers from the side as a branch. Okay, so these are the various configuration of the polymer molecules. So based on the number of monomers used and their presence or sequence in the polymer chain, we can classify the polymers in this way. The next topic, chemical structure of the monomer. So based on the chemical structure of the monomer, the polymer can be classified in two ways, addition polymer and the condensation polymer. So this thing has been demonstrated here by some figure. Here you can see there's a monomers, all the monomers are similar type, same monomers. When all the same monomers are joined together to form a polymer by the polymerization process, this will appear like this, a linear chain polymer. Okay, there is no molecules, okay, which are basically extracted or which are generated as waste or byproduct during the polymerization process. Whereas in case of condensation polymer, you can see there are two dissimilar type of molecules, dissimilar type of monomers A and B. Okay, they are added together during the polymerization process, and during the polymerization process there will be low molecular weight compounds which will be eradicated as a byproduct, and the polymer which will be produced as ABAB form. Okay, so main difference between the addition and condensation polymerization is that in case of addition polymerization, there is no molecules, there is no compounds which are produced as byproduct or waste. All the monomers are added together, 100% utilization is there to form the polymer, whereas in case of condensation polymerization, some low molecular weight compounds such as water molecules or some low molecular weight gases, they will discharge from the polymerization process as byproduct or waste, and a polymer will be formed. So as per the chemical structure of the monomer, in this way the polymer can be classified. Now next topic is functionality of the monomer. Now based on the functionality of the monomer, the polymer can be classified as linear polymer, branched polymer, cross-linked polymer, and network polymer. So based on the functionality of the monomer molecules can link together or join together to form various types of polymers. Either the configuration will be linear, branched, cross-linking, or network form. So figures are shown here, A, B, C, D. Here you can see in case of A, there is all the molecules which are very, very linear oriented. In case of B, branched polymer, some polymer molecules, some monomer molecules which are added with the main chain of the polymer, like a branch, so there are some branching appears here. In case of cross-linked polymer, there will be some tie molecules or cross-linked molecules which are joining adjacent polymer molecules. Okay, in case of network polymer, the cross-linking or the intermolecular linkage is very, very rigorous, okay, in the form of network. Then polymer structure phases. So this is the different topic. Okay, various structural phases of the polymer. So, based on the chemical structure of the polymer, various structural phases of the polymers are decided. Okay, so most important is the primary structure. This is also named as configuration or molecular configuration. The sequence of repeat units with a polymer is called primary structure. In the particular or the typical sequence in which the polymer molecule is made, that is the primary structure. Okay, such as in case of this cellulosic fiber, there is a sequence of monomer units. Okay, the cell, there is a repeat unit of cell bios, and there is a particular sequence. And when you are talking about polyamide 6, there is a sequence of carbon, nitrogen and carbon atoms. So this typical sequence is here. That sequence of repeat unit within a polymer is called primary structure. It relates the exact order of arrangement of the atoms or molecules in the polymer chain forming the long chain molecules. So this is the primary structure. It is named as configuration. So here in this slide, the configuration or primary structure of few of the textile fibers are shown, such as cellulose, nylon 6, polyethylene, okay, polyester, polyacrylonitrile, etc. Now, better I can explain the configuration again. The configuration is a concept that is related to the order by which different substituents link to the same central atom and establish a covalent bond. Okay, so this is the concept of configuration. You can see in this figure. Okay, so here the order of the chlorine hydrogen is in this way. Then the transform is established. If chlorine hydrogen, hydrogen chlorine, the order has been changed. You can see the chlorine hydrogen, then chlorine supposed to be there, but hydrogen position of the hydrogen and chlorine atom has been interchanged. So now this configuration is called as cis configuration. So here the order of the arrangement of the substituent links has been changed. Okay, at the central atom. So this is the central atom, carbon atom. Here this order has been changed. Okay, so this order has been changed with respect to the establishment of the covalent bond. So when such happen, okay, the chemical formula is same, okay, molecular weight will be same, but still the configuration will be different. Such kind of occurrence is called as molecular configuration. The two polymers which have the same chemical composition but can only be made identical, that is superimposable, by breaking and reforming the bonds are said to be two configuration of the polymer. Now you can see this trans and cis form. Okay, they have the same chemical composition but they are not identical. If you want to make them identical, they are not identical, their property will be different. But if you want to make them identical polymer, then you need to break this covalent bond. And again you have to reform the bond. Okay, you need chlorine at the place of hydrogen and a hydrogen in place of chlorine. So to make such order, you need to break the covalent bond and again you have to reform the bond so that you can avail the transform in place of cis form. So then this type of configuration is called is, this type of structure, chemical structure is called as molecular configuration. The polymer that contains asymmetric carbon atom or that contain double bond. Okay, there is a double bond. So in that case, generally the configuration appears. A system, asymmetric carbon atoms can exist in D or L state, while the double bond can exist in cis or trans state. Cis and trans state has been shown here in this slide. Now secondary structure. So I have discussed the primary structure so far, that is the molecular configuration. Now I shall discuss the secondary structure, which is called as conformation. Okay, molecular conformation. The secondary structure refers to the localized shape of the polymer, which is often consequences of hydrogen bonding. Localized shape of the polymer molecule. Okay, if the molecule is a straight chain molecule or it is a folded chain configuration or a coil configuration. So such type of straight chain, folded chain or coil chain, if happens due to the consequences of hydrogen bonding, okay, or some you can say temporary shape, then it is called molecular configuration. It also indicates the geometrical configuration. Either it is called molecular conformation or it is called geometrical configuration of the long chain polymer molecules. The same polymer with same configuration but differ only by rotation about the single bond is said to be two different conformation of the polymer. Here you can see the difference between the configuration and conformation. Okay, in case of conformation, there will be the rotation of the polymer chain about a single bond. Okay, there is no concept of double bond. There will be the rotation. Suppose one example is even here, this figure you can see. Okay, here you can see the position of this black point, that is the black group, black functional group. Okay, here if you can make the difference, here in this case there is a 180 degree rotation of this bond, single bond. Okay, so this type of configuration, this type of conformation has been appear. Okay, 180 degree rotation about the single bond. This is the single bond, there will be the 180 degree rotation of the single bond. So this type of chemical structure is called molecular conformation. Okay, now tertiary structure. The tertiary structure refers to the overall shape of the polymer. Okay, it indicates the spatial arrangement of the molecular chains and the interaction between the side groups of the chain or chains. So this is the feature of the tertiary structure, that is the spatial arrangement of the molecular chain and the interaction between the side groups of the chain or chains. Okay, if there is any intermolecular interaction present between the two polymer molecules, and if there are side groups, and the side groups how are interacting, okay, between the molecules, and the spatial arrangement of the molecule, that is the tertiary structure. Then last one, the quaternary structure. This refers to the arrangement in space of two or more polymer subunits, often a grouping of tertiary structure. Many crystalline synthetic polymer form spherulides. Okay, quaternary structure is actually representing a group of molecules, group of polymer molecules, how they are existing in a small space. Okay, grouping of molecules. Okay, for example, the spherulides. What is spherulide? That I shall discuss later again. A spherulide, you can say a crystallite, a smallest form of crystal. Okay, in a crystal there will be a number of molecules, okay, which are arranged together to form a crystallite, a small form of crystal. So that is the quaternary structure. Okay, when the molecules are arranged, a number of molecules are arranged in a space, okay, with two or more than two polymer subunit, then a quaternary structure can be defined. Now come to the structure of the cellulosic fiber. So you know the cellulose is the most abundant polymer in nature. Dry wood consists of 40-55% cellulose, 15-35% lignin, and 25-40% hemicellulose. So this is the composition of the wood. Wood is the largest source of cellulosic polymer or cellulosic material, or simply cellulose, of the largest source of cellulose, and that's why the wood has been used for the manufacturing of regenerated cellulosic fiber. So cellulose is a structural material in plants. and also occurs in certain bacteria and some marine organisms. So other source of cellulose are the certain bacteria and some marine organisms. These are the three sources of cellulose basically. In cotton fiber, it is found in almost pure form. Okay, because the percentage of lignin and hemicellulose is very, very less in case of cotton. That's why in cotton, the cellulose is available in very, very pure form. The glucose, the chemical formula is C6H12O6, has a ring structure of 1 oxygen atom and 5 CH group, 4 with pendant hydroxyl groups and 1 with pendant methyl hydroxyl group, CH2H group. Okay, that is the chemical structure of glucose. You can see here, this is the structure of a glucose unit. Okay, now these rings are not flat. The glucose ring is not flat but bent in a chair configuration, and each successive unit is rotated to 180 degree with respect to the molecular axis. So you can see that glucose unit, they are added together to form a cellulosic polymer. Now these glucose units are not flat, they are actually present in a chair configuration, like this configuration which is shown here in this figure A. This is the exact or right chemical structure of presenting the cellulose molecules which is present in the cotton fiber. They are present in a chair configuration, and each successive glucose unit that is rotated to 180 degree, you can see the difference, the presence of the cellulosic ring that is rotated about 180 degree with respect to the molecular axis. So this is the typical feature of the chemical structure of the cellulosic chain. Now for the formation of the cellulose within plant cell, glucose molecules come to enzyme complexes and add on successively with the elimination of water to form the long chain molecules. So this is the method of polymerization by the glucose molecules. Okay, when the glucose molecules are come together in the plant cell, where the cellulose molecules are synthesized by the plant, they will come to the enzyme complexes and add on successively with no elimination of water. That means one type of addition polymerization has been occurred to form the long chain molecules. It is shown here schematically in this figure A. Irregular conformation with distributed hydrogen bonds are found in amorphous region of the regenerated fiber. So in the amorphous zone, there are two zones available in the structure of the fiber. One is the amorphous zone and another is the crystalline zone. Okay, in the amorphous zone, hydrogen bonds are present. Okay, then the hydrogen bonds are present most irregularly. There will be the irregular conformation have been observed in the amorphous zone. Okay, hydrogen bonds are present between the hydroxyl groups of the two adjacent glucose molecules. Okay, this is the hydrogen bond which is represented in figure B. The molecule is unbranched and unfolded. Okay, all the cellulose molecules, they are unbranched. There is no branching available in cotton fiber and they are unfolded. All the molecules are straight, no folding. Okay, in a cellulosic crystal. So this type of observations already have been made and available in literature. Various researchers have investigated about the structure and they have reported in this way. That's why we are pretty much can learn from those papers and information which are available in various books and journals. It is estimated that the natural cellulosic chain contains about 10 to the power 4 glucose rings. So a single cellulosic chain or cellulosic molecule is consisting of 10 to the power 4 glucose rings. Okay, 10 to the power 4 glucose molecules are there in a serologic molecules, okay, which is giving a length of 5 micrometer. The length of the serologic chain is 5 micrometer and width is 8 into 10 to the power minus 4 millimeter. Okay, this is the typical dimension of a serologic chain or cellulose molecule in a cotton fiber. There are a number of active sites on the enzyme complexes. Okay, in the enzyme complex where the formation of the cellulose molecules occurs, okay, there are a number of sites, active sites are there in the enzyme complex, so that about 30 cellulosic chain molecules form together and crystallize to form a fibril. Okay, as you know, the fibrils are there in the cotton fiber. Okay, that's why cotton fiber is called as fibrillar structures. So there are 30 cellulose molecules, they come together to form a fibril. Fibril is a crystalline phase of the material, crystalline phase of the cotton fiber, and there are 30 cellulose molecules which will form a single fibril. The crystalline form, it is known as cellulose 1. Okay, the crystalline form of the fiber is called as cellulose 1 and has all the chains running in the same direction. Okay, all the fibrils are cellulose 1 structure. Okay, they all are running in the same direction. There is no folding. Okay, straight configuration. Two-thirds crystalline. The fibrils are typically two-thirds crystalline. That means 70% of the zone in the fibril are crystalline. The fibrils are then laid down in helical layers to form the cell wall of the plants. Okay, if you can see the cell wall, microstructure of the cell wall of cotton fiber, you can see there are some helical layers of the fibril. Okay, the fibrils are laid down helically on the primary cell wall. In dry fiber, there is hydrogen bonding between the fibril, but this reduces as water is absorbed with a consequence of reduction in mechanical stiffness. Okay, the dry fiber, in dry fiber, there are more number of hydrogen bonds. Okay, that's why the dry fibers are stiffer one. So as soon as the dry cotton fiber will absorb moisture, the hydrogen bonds will break and the fiber become much flexible. The stiffness will go down gradually upon absorption of the moisture. When the cellulose is dissolved or swell in caustic soda during mercerization, the parallel arrangement of the molecule is lost. The molecules which are there in the fibril, they are almost arranged parallelly. But during swelling or caustic soda mercerization, the parallel arrangement of the molecule will lose. Recrystallization adopts a preferred cellulose 2 form in anti-parallel chain. Then the cellulose 1 configuration will convert it to cellulose 2, okay, which is the anti-parallel chain. The parallel configuration will dismiss and anti-parallel configuration will now form after the swelling or mercerization. So these are the various features of the chemical structure of the cellulosic cotton fiber. In the living seed cell, as you know, the cotton fiber is a seed cell, the seed fiber, okay, that is generating from the seed. Okay, it's a unicellular fiber, a single cell fiber. In a living seed cell, the cellulose molecules grow by the addition of glucose molecules at enzyme complex. Already I have mentioned. The process of polymerization is called as virgin polymerization. The polymerization process, which is controlled by the plant, is called virgin polymerization. The 30 molecules form at each enzyme complex and assemble into fibril, which are the building block of the structure of the fiber. First, a primary cell wall form with an ultimate dimension of the fiber. Okay, at first the primary cell wall will form which is the ultimate dimension of the fiber. First dimension of the fiber will be fixed, then the bulk of the material is laid down in helical layers at a secondary level. That's why you see the helix angle of 20 to 30 degree of the fibrils around or on the primary and secondary cell wall. At maturity, there is still an open lumen. Okay, there will be the open lumen at the center of the fiber. In case of mature fiber, you can see the lumens are more prominent, which collapses to give a kidney-shaped fiber cross-section. That you know, here the kidney-shaped fiber cross-section. Okay, this is the cross-section of the cotton fiber has been taken by the scanning electron microscopes, and this is the morphology of the surface of the single cotton fiber, where you can see primary cell wall, secondary cell wall, and the lumen, and the helical displacement or the helical positions of the fibril, which are present on the primary and secondary cell wall of the cotton fiber. So diameter of the cotton fiber is 12 to 20 micrometer. It is a single cell or unicellular fiber. So the structure of the cotton fiber is described as helical ribbon shape, reversal spiral. You can see in the primary wall the direction of the spiral, and in the secondary cell wall, secondary wall, the direction of the spiral, that is the reversal direction, reverse direction. Okay. Helix angle is 30 degree and 67% crystallinity is there in the cotton fiber. So now cotton fiber chain details. Degree of polymerization is more than 10,000. Molecule is ribbon shape, rigidity and flexibility is there. And extensive hydrogen bonding is also there in the cotton fiber. Then the bast fiber. Bast fibers are also the cellulosic fibers such as flax, hemp, jute. Okay, they are multicellular fiber. They are not unicellular fiber like cotton. They have the less percentage of cellulose, because as I have mentioned, the cotton fiber is having the purest form of the cellulose, where the largest part is cellulose and hemicellulose and lignin part is lowest. But in case of bast fiber, the cellulose percentage is lesser than that of the cotton fiber. Helix angle is smaller, 70 to 15 degree, than that of the cotton fiber. Now cellulose acetate, where hydroxyl groups are replaced by acetyl group, CH3COO group. Okay, there are two types of acetate fiber, secondary acetate and tertiary acetate. In secondary acetate, 1 to 2 groups are replaced by the acetyl group, less crystalline due to bulky side group, because the acetyl groups are much bulkier than that of the hydroxyl groups. Okay, the fibers are weak and extensible. In tertiary acetate, 3 hydroxyl groups are actually replaced by the acetyl groups. Okay, they are the 40% crystalline. Okay, greater dimensional stability and resistance. These are the advantages of the tertiary acetate fiber. The greater dimensional stability and better ridge resistance. Now come to the structure of the wool fiber. So wool fiber is a hair fiber. The fiber grows from the follicle in the skin of the sheep. They are composed of many elongated cells linked by a cell membrane complex which contains peptides. Okay, peptide is a protein. The keratin protein is laid down in sequence as the cell grows. Okay, keratin is the name of the protein in the wool fiber. You know, keratin crystallizes in an alpha helical lattice, which under tension opens to extended beta configuration. Okay, there is a two form of the keratin protein, alpha and beta form. Alpha is a helical form and beta is extended form. Okay, when wool fiber is extended, the alpha configuration is converted to the beta configuration. The molecules assemble, the keratin molecules assemble in a sequence of twisted pair to form fibril containing 32 molecules. Here in the wool fiber, fibrils are also there, but here the fibrils are made of 32 keratin molecules. The protein form in the outer cell to give a multi-layer cuticle. In the wool fiber, cuticle is there, which is the surface of the fiber. The core of the fiber is divided into an ortho and paracortex. The core is called cortex, and the cortex is also divided into form orthocortex and paracortex, with a difference in the composition of the keratin associated protein, AAPs. Okay, there is the difference in the composition of the keratin associated protein in the ortho and paracortex. Due to this difference, the orthocortex and the paracortex contract dissimilarly on drying. During the drying process, the rate of contraction and the amount of contraction by the orthocortex and the paracortex is different. Okay, this difference in the contraction is causing the cream in the wool fiber. That's why the wool fiber is having the natural cream or natural waviness. Okay, the cuticle has a structure of scales. Okay, you know the cotton fiber is having scales, so the scales are present in the cuticle, or the you can say the scales are actually forming the cuticle, which are like an encampment with steep faces towards the tip and gentle slope to the root. Okay, so you can see that all the scales are unidirectional. Okay, the tip of the scales towards the end of the fiber, not the towards the root of the fiber. So unidirectional scales are there. That's why if you rub the fiber from root to tip, the friction will be less. But if you rub the fiber from the direction of the tip to root, then the friction will be high. So that difference friction is also called as directional frictional effect, DEF. Okay, that is the cause of felting of the wool fiber. So wool fiber is having only 25-30% crystallinity, and which is having a fringed fibril structure. So I shall discuss later on what is fringed fibril structure. Now fibril, that term already you know, there are fibrils in the wool fiber, and in a fibril there are 32 protein molecules. Now in silk, the silk are simpler protein block copolymers. Okay, the silk is called as block copolymers, which form within the gland cells of the silkworm. The process is simpler to solution spinning of manufactured fiber. You know the solution spinning of manufactured fiber, such as viscose fiber. The silk is also one kind of manufactured fiber, which is manufactured by the silkworm. But as it is not manufactured by mankind, so that's why you cannot say as the manufactured fiber. Okay, it is a natural fiber, but which is manufactured by the silkworm. Okay, but because there are important differences between the manufactured fiber, such as cellulosic fibers, and the silk, such as regenerated cellulosic fiber or viscose fiber, and the manufacturing of the silk. Okay, here the polymerization is also called as virgin polymerization. Okay, so during the spinning, or just after the spinning, there will be the solidification of the spun silk filament occurs, and the surface layer will dry quickly. So that's why the surface molecules are having the low orientation, and the core, inside the core, which solidify in a slower rate, is showing the higher molecular orientation. So that is why this kind of difference in the molecular orientation across the cross section of the silk filament happens. Okay, so that's why the fiber is having a silk core type of structure. Outer layer coagulates first, lower time for the orientation, followed by middle and the next, the inner layer, which I have just discussed. The silk is also having a fibrillar structure, which is 65-70% crystalline, like cotton. So slow growth, centimeter per minute for the silk. The manufacturing rate of the silk filament by the silkworm is centimeter, 1 centimeter per minute. And in case of cotton, the manufacturing rate is centimeter per month, much lower. And in case of wool also, the same, 1 centimeter per 1 month. So this is a very, very slow growth compared to the kilometer per minute in industrial production. Okay, industrial production of the polyester, nylon, viscose, they have the production rate of 1 kilometer per minute, which is much high. So one of the difference between the manufacturing of the natural fiber and the manufactured fiber by mankind is that the slow growth of the manufacturing of the, or the slow growth of the natural fiber such as cotton, silk and wool. And another important difference is the genetic control by the plant or the animals during the manufacturing of the natural fiber led to complex specificity in the fiber structure that cannot be matched in commercial manufacturing. The genetic control or the process control, which is governed by the plant in case of cotton, or the silkworm or animal in case of silk and wool, that is difficult to imitate. Okay, we cannot imitate, we cannot exactly control in the similar way for the manufacturing of the cotton, silk or wool in laboratory. Okay, so that is why the quality of the natural fiber is so good and degree of polymerization is so high that cannot be achieved in the laboratory. We cannot manufacture the cotton, wool and silk in laboratory because we cannot afford such slow growth in the laboratory development of the fibers, and as well as we cannot control the process of polymerization. Okay, the genetic control which has been given or which has been governed by the plant, that is very difficult to understand and difficult to achieve in laboratory setup. So this is there due to the virgin polymerization and the concept of virgin polymerization in the manufacturing of the natural fibers are there. Okay, now the next topic I shall discuss onwards from the next class onwards, the requirement of fiber forming polymers. So I shall stop here. Happy learning. I shall advise to go through the books of the Morton and Hurley to understand the basic chemical and physical structure of the fiber from the books, because without reading from the books, your knowledge will not be appropriate. So I shall advise to go through the books again and again. Okay, thank you. Happy learning.